Welcome to Communication Skills Week 1. The topic for this week is Introduction to Communication Skills. The objectives to this week's lesson are the following: that by the end of the topic, we shall be able to define the term communication. We'll also be able to state and explain the elements of communication, to discuss the barriers to effective communication, suggest ways to overcoming the barriers to communication, and we shall also be able to relate the models of communication to various communication settings. Now, the term communication has been defined by many scholars, and in our general view, or the general understanding of communication, is that it is an exchange of information, it is a deliberation, it is a discussion. It involves people passing on information through various means. You could be talking through word of mouth, or you could do it through writing. And nowadays, with advances in technology, there are very many ways of relaying communication from one person to another. But in all those meanings and interpretations of communication, one thing is certain: that for communication to take place, there must be more than one person, because like we are saying, it is an exchange of information. So from your handout, which you should be having by now, we have talked about various definitions. Like I've said, they may use different terms and different words or different phrases, but in the long run, the meaning is more or less the same. So I'll just pick on one definition, and probably we can talk about this one definition, and then the other definitions you can just read them direct from your handout. So I'll pick a definition that is by one person known as Keith Davis. And according to Davis, communication is the process of passing information and understanding from one person to another. So just like I had mentioned, there must be more than one party for communication or effective communication to take place. Peter Little also defines communication as a process by which information is transmitted between individuals and or organizations that an understanding response results. So here we are not talking just about individuals, but also organizations. So if we interpret that, a definition is that an individual can communicate to another individual, an individual can communicate to an organization, or an organization can communicate to an individual. But what is important is for us to understand the fact that communication is a process involving more than one person. The summary on the definition indicates that, or rather emphasizes on various issues to do with the definition to communication, one of them being that there has to be something to be communicated. There has to be a content, the message. Then the second thing the definitions bring out is that communication is an accurate replication in the receiver's mind. That when you communicate to the other person, if your communication is clear enough, then the other person should be able to perceive and understand the message in the same manner that you perceived it when you are sending it to them. The other thing that comes out of the definitions is that there should be feedback from the recipient. If somebody receives a message and they do not respond, then that process is not complete. And then it also emphasizes on the fact that there has to be more than one person, or there has to be parties involved in communication. Now, in regard to the definitions, then, the main aspects of communication involves the following: that communication must have a source, the person who initiates the process, and that is the person we are referring to as a sender, And we have said the sender of the message can either be an individual or a corporate or an organization. Then the other aspect of communication is the content. There must be the message that is being communicated. The third one is media. The media is the channel or the way in which you choose to pass your message. Once there is a sender and the message to be sent is there, then the sender determines the best media to be used. It can be through word of mouth if the person you are communicating to is reachable. It can be through a phone call. It can be through an email and many others, channels of communication like we are going to be discussing in other weeks. Then the message or the communication must have a destination. And the destination is the person we are calling the recipient, the person who gets the message on the other end. And then since we have said that the message cannot be complete or the communication process cannot be complete without the feedback, then the feedback is the last aspect of communication. So for that process to be complete, for it to be defined to us, communication in its fullness or in its entirety, then it must contain those aspects, which are the sender, the message, the media, the recipient, and the feedback. Now, further to that, we have the characteristics of communication. And usually when a characteristic of something lacks, then it ceases to be complete. So again, the characteristics or the terms that we can use to define or to describe communication are the following: that communication maintains and animates life since it creates a common pool of ideas, strengthens the feeling of togetherness through exchange of messages, and it translates thought into action. So if you conceive a message and then you keep it to yourself, if it is not communicated, it remains with you. But if you conceive it, you communicate it, and the other person understands it and sends you some feedback, that is where we are saying to some extent communication maintains and animates life. Meaning it contributes in a big way to the social being of an individual or even a group or a team. The other characteristic of communication is that it is an interchange of information, like we said, especially that process of sending a message, somebody understanding it and interpreting it and sending a back feedback. It becomes an interchange or a deliberation, some kind of discussion. And then the third characteristic is that it is a continuous process. Usually when you get the feedback from the recipient, there is a likelihood that you are going to send further information to that person, and therefore the process does not end there. The other characteristic is that there is mutual understanding, that is between the receiver of the message and the sender of the message. The other one is response or reaction. Apart from just giving feedback to the message, sometimes the messages that are sent in communication are some kind of instructions. And when you are given instructions, then you are supposed to act upon those instructions. Therefore, we expect some form of response or reaction. So those are the major ones. There are two others which you can read there from the handout that is with you. Then we can talk about the importance of communication. Now, as we know, people cannot remain without communication. Even if you are just in one place with somebody, even if it is not an organization, it is not likely that you can stay with someone for a given length of time without saying anything to one another. So communication is key. Like we have brought in the aspect of life, communication is always there with us, although we shall mostly be majoring on official communication. So the importance of communication, especially in organizations, the first one applies to the big size organizations. When you approach good and effective communication methods, then it becomes very easy to reach everybody within the organization. The big size of organizations are mostly the ones that have got even more than one branch. We've got people working all over the country, and it is possible to reach them. Like when you embrace technology at the click of a button, you can reach all the employees in a company that has got branches even worldwide, leave alone in one country. So communication acts to make, passing of information easy in big size organizations. Then it also addresses the growing importance of human relations. Human relations addresses the way people relate with one another within an organization. Like the employees who work within an organization, they refer to one another as colleagues. The way they relate with one another, that is human relations, and communication enhances the quality of human relations between people in one organization. Then it also aids in enhancing public relations. Unlike human relations, public relations addresses the relationship between an organization and the outside world. The other people who are interested with the ongoings of the organization, the stakeholders, people who do business with the organization, people who sell items and services to them, people who buy from them. We have also the potential employees, people who are interested in working for the organization, but they have not been hired by that organization. We have others like the community living around the area where an organization is located and operating. So the way you relate with all those is public relations, and communication is key when it comes to the public relations. Public relations can make or destroy an organization. If an organization has got a bad name out there, then you lose customers, you even lose potential employees. Excuse me. Then the other importance of communication is that it advances behavioral science. Issues to do with sociology, psychology, philosophy, and transactional analysis. The way people perceive things, the way people relate with one another, the way people understand issues. And then we also have technological advances. In the modern world, everything is being done in a very advanced manner. We have embraced technology in everything that we are doing, and communication has not been left behind. Now, communication, like we have talked about the aspects of human relations and public relations. So we also have internal communication, and we also have external communication. And the importance of internal communication addresses issues to do with human relations, while the importance of external communication addresses issues to do with public relations, and they have been outlined there very clearly. Then we have the models or the theories of communication. We shall be looking at just a few. The first one being the linear process model. This one is the cheapest, the easiest model of communication. And if you can envision the model, imagine of a straight line, and then we have the sender of the message on one end, and we have the receiver of the message on the other end. So along the line that is connecting the sender and the receiver, we have the message. That is the easiest way that I can describe the linear model. Then an advanced model, which is more advanced than the linear, is the interactive process model. And this one, we are calling it an advancement of the linear model. So we still have the sender and the receiver on the other end. And then we also bring in the issues of interpreting the message once the receiver receives it, and then the issue of feedback. So the interactive process brings in the aspect of a two-way process, whereby it is not only the sender who is communicating. After the receiver gets the message, they also communicate back because they are giving their feedback. And then we have the transactional process model. That's the third one. And this one brings in a more dynamic process of communication. It brings in the issues of the way a receiver receives the message and the way the information is sent, like when you are talking on phone. There is that simultaneous way of communicating because we have like two people are talking at the same time, but we have one person waiting for the other to talk so that they can give back the feedback. So, and in this kind of communication, then feedback is instant because you are discussing. You don't send the message and then you wait to get the response. Now, in regard to those three models, we have then the communication process. Remember, in the introduction, we've already said that it is a continuous process beginning from the sender to the receiver and back to the sender until the two parties achieve what was aimed to be achieved by the receiver and the sender in the first place. So for the communication process to be effective and to be complete, we have the elements or the components of communication, which I'll just rush through because I've been mentioning them. So we have the sender. There must be a sender of the message, the person who initiates the process. Then we have the receiver, the person who was targeted by the sender in the first place. That is the person who receives, interprets, and then sends feedback to the message. Then we have the feedback itself, the response that we get from the receiver. We have the context, that is what the message entails. This is the bulk of what is communicated by both parties. Now, the other item, which is listed as one of the elements of or components of communication, which is not desirable, but we always find it there, is noise. Noise is a negative aspect, and it normally disrupts the flow of communication. And noise, in this sense, refers to any factors which prevent proper exchange of information, apart from the sender or receiver. And I will not dwell on that because later on we are going to have a subtopic on noise. So the other component in the communication process is the message, what is being communicated. Remember, we said before the sender initiates the process, they must have thought of the message that they want to send. And then we have the medium that is going to be used to send the message from the sender to the receiver. And we also have the channel, depending on the medium that the sender wants to use. If, for example, it is going to be verbal, then the sender can choose whether to meet the person physically or make a telephone call. If it is written, there are many channels of sending written communication. So all those things must be in existence for communication to take place, for the process to kick off and go all the way to completion. Now, when it comes to the channel, like we are saying, there are many channels of communication, which we shall also be discussing as we move on. And in most circumstances or situations, these channels are available to us, to the people who wants to send messages. But you need to be careful when you are determining which channel to use, and therefore we look at the factors to consider when choosing a channel of communication. The first one, which is of most importance, either to an individual or to the organization, is the cost. The cost of the channel. If you have a variety to choose from and all of them are equally effective, then definitely you'd go for the cheaper channel. The other thing is urgency, how fast you want the message to get to the recipient. And when you consider the issues of urgency, then you may need to forego the issue of cost. The other one is confidentiality. Again, depending on the sensitivity of the content of the communication, you will choose the most confidential channel that is going to suit your purpose. Reliability, the channel has to be reliable. In other words, once you send the message to the recipient, it must reach the recipient and it must reach them without being distorted. Then we have the distance, how far or how long it will take for you to get to the recipient. And therefore, this one will really determine so that you can choose a channel that is going to take the shortest time to reach them. And some of these factors are considered in relation to one another. So one factor can affect another factor. Like when we talk about distance and there is an issue of urgency, then you use the two to determine which is the best method to get to somebody who is very far away within the shortest time possible. We also have the details of the message. Whichever channel that you choose must be able to accommodate all the details in the message. And then we also consider the receiver. The receiver must be comfortable with whichever channel that you choose. The channel must be available to them. It must be reachable to them. You cannot decide to make a telephone call to somebody who does not have a telephone set in the first place. Then from there, we go to the communication process. I've already alluded to this communication process. It begins by the sender of the message conceiving the message. In other words, the need arises for you to send some communication to someone. Then after you conceive the message, as the sender, you're supposed to encode that message. Encoding means putting it in a form. In the format that which is going to make it possible for you to send it to another person. Now, encoding, for example, can mean putting it in writing or recording it in a place and any other way that you'd want to encode your message. Then from there, you select the medium which you're going to use to get the message to the recipient. And then you interpret the message. Now, interpreting the message is assigning the meaning of the message to be received. You put it in a format which you're now going to send to the receiver. And then you, in the process of interpreting, you are also sending. Like if you are calling someone, you make the phone call, you pass the information to them. So at the end of this message interpretation, it means the recipient will be in custody of the communication. So the next part of the process becomes the feedback. When the person on the other end receives it, they are supposed to encode it, to decode it, or to interpret it, and then they can send their feedback. Now, because of the technicalities of the process and the channel and the fact that we are dealing with more than one person in the communication process, we have the barriers to effective communication. Remember somewhere we mentioned noise, and I said we shall be talking about it later, and it's going to feature now in the barriers to communication. A barrier is anything that hinders the smooth flow of communication. Anything that can, for example, distort a message or make the message not reach the intended person, probably interfere with the time, interfere with the quality of the message, or interfere with the process in any other way. And we have various barriers to communication. The first one are what we are calling mechanical barriers. Mechanical barriers will mostly affect the channel. So we are talking of things like the quality of microphones. If you are communicating, for example, to many people, anything affecting the sound, the quality of the sound, and probably how audible that sound is. And then we also have issues to do with the defects in telephone lines. Probably you are in the process of communicating and there is power failure, and whichever gadget you are using is powered by electricity. It could also affect hard copy communication. If you have a printer that has got a poor quality print, we also have the atmosphere where the communication is being passed. So all those are mechanical barriers, and there could be many others that we are not mentioning here. Then the second one is the physical barriers. Under physical barriers, we have noise. I already mentioned about noise, and I said it is anything that can disrupt communication. Now, in this particular case, we are talking about noise in the actual sense of that word, like noise from motor vehicles, you know, like the blaring and loud speakers that we normally hear along the streets. If, for example, somebody calls you and you are walking along the streets, there could be that form of interruption. Then we have time and distance. Remember we said when you are considering the channel, you must look at some of these things like time and distance, and therefore time and distance can act as a barrier to communication in different ways. There could be delays, there could be distortions, and a message can also get lost along the way such that it doesn't reach the intended recipient. Then we have psychological barriers. Anything psychological has everything to do with the mind and also people's capabilities to follow up in the process. So like we have people who have got weak hearing, their ears have got weaknesses, or a poor eyesight, and you've sent a written communication. Sometimes the age of the recipient can also be an issue. If somebody is too young or too old to understand certain things within the context of a communication, a person's educational level can also affect and become a barrier. For example, when we talk about language issues, then or you are passing a message that has got some very technical language. For example, when a doctor, you know, does a diagnosis and hands over that diagnosis to a patient who does not understand the medical language, cannot interpret it, and will have to depend on other people to interpret for them. We also have gender barriers. You can communicate something to the opposite gender and it is interpreted to be not to be acceptable, and it can end up being a barrier. Issues to do with the concentration of both the recipient and the sender. If any of you is having a wandering mind, that one will definitely distort the communication and the message therein. So we have many others. That's a wide category of psychological barriers, all which can affect effectiveness of a communication. Then the other category of barriers is semantic and language barriers. Issues to do with pronunciation of words, different meanings of the same words. You can mention a word which means something different to the other person, and therefore they don't get exactly what you are communicating to them. Then we have information overload, when there is too much information to be communicated at the same time, meaning the recipient will understand the bits and the pieces of the communication. Then if any of the parties is in a restrictive environment, probably you are making a telephone call and one of you is in a place where they are not even supposed to be talking. For example, if you are in a meeting or something, or you are in a church, that is a restrictive environment, and therefore communication may not be very possible. So those are the barriers to communication. You can go through them again and read to your own understanding. And then we have the principles which also serve as qualities of effective communication. And from what we have already discussed, these are they are going to be straightforward. So the first one is for communication to be said to be of good quality, it has to be clear. The message has to be clear, and it begins with the thoughts of the person who is initiating the communication. When they are sending the message, we have the clarity of expression. They have to express themselves in a very clear way. And for you to be able to express yourself clearly, the language you use must be understood by yourself and the person that you are communicating to. So you are supposed to avoid issues such as use of jargon. Jargon is the use of words which are not they are not technical terms, they are not official terms. On the streets they can be understood, but when it comes to business communication, we are supposed to avoid such words. Then you also avoid being ambiguous. Whatever you explain, ensure you go to the point, you can be understood, and if you are told to repeat what you have said, you can be able to say it again. Then we are advised to use short sentences when we are communicating, to use simple words, avoid the use of heavy vocabulary. And then we are also supposed to use concrete expressions. The way you communicate and the person you are communicating to is left without any doubt. So all that refers to clarity as quality of good communication. Then the other quality is conciseness. Messages must be concise. They must be to the point. You don't need to add unnecessary information to anything that you are communicating. Then the other quality is consideration. In this regard, you're supposed, for example, to consider the person that is going to access that communication, so that you don't do anything or you don't involve anything that is going to be too hard for them to be able to access or even to interpret. The other thing you consider as a quality of good communication is courtesy. Courtesy towards the person you are communicating to. And then the other one is completeness. This is completeness of the message. It must contain all the details that you need the other person to receive. Then we have the correctness as the final quality of an effective communication. So whatever facts that you send, they must be correct. They should not be questionable. So that if, like we said, because you are going to be expecting feedback from the other side,